Hi, everyone. This is Andrew Oppmann with a special edition of Out of the Blue. We're doing web-only episodes that we call Stay on Course. And these episodes focus on the people and processes at the university responding to the COVID-19 crisis. Today is Thursday, May 21st. Joining me on the program, Dr. Lana Seivers, Dean of the College of Education at MTSU. Well, Dean, thank you for joining us on the show. We appreciate your time.
Thanks, Andrew. It's good to be here.
I've been starting every one of these episodes where I interview the deans and with the question of when did COVID-19 become real for you? When did you realize the world was going to change?
Mm-hmm. There are two things for me. One, my mother is in an independent living facility here in Murfreesboro, and they closed it down to visitors on March 10th. So I'm thinking, well, that's a little premature. And then about 3 days later, as our student teachers were completing their first school assignment and getting ready to go to the second, we realized that wasn't going to happen anytime soon. We thought it would be delayed. We knew the university was going to be changing or at least delaying our spring break. We then started learning that schools and school districts were kind of watching and seeing what the state was going to do, what the governor recommended. And we knew early on that at least for our student teachers, things would be changing. Then it became a reality for the entire university. And life as we knew it changed. And when you're talking about teachers who work with children from pre-K through grade 12, that's a huge adjustment.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And of course, you mentioned spring break, and then the world changed. For the university, we had to move to remote delivery of instruction. You had to get all of your graduates across the finish line and finish the semester for everybody. I know you're proud of your faculty. Can you talk about how that worked in the College of Education?
Well, I think one unique thing about our faculty is every single one of them have been teachers in pre-K-12 before. So it's just natural for their focus to be on what do my students need. And that's how they've approached this. They're all part of the school climate, the school culture, being actually in the schools. They know what we do in terms of our practical experiences in the schools with our students going in. So the challenge for them was not just content delivery and getting that online, but how to make really meaningful experiences when their students can't go into a school. How do you do that? And they have been absolutely creative. And I think it shows a level of collaboration they have with our school partners, because together with their teachers, our faculty, and our students, we engaged everybody in working with our mentor teachers in our schools in everything from Facebook to Zoom meetings with families and children. It's just been an exciting time in that regard. We didn't just say, okay, we're done because the schools are closed. We still were a part of what those teachers do, because I think that's a big part of what we try to do in teacher training. We're preparing them for the world they're going into. I mean, that's just it. And sometimes that world changes. Good teachers monitor and adjust all the time. That's just what we do.
Now, I know you've been in touch with our alums who are like you described, they're having to come up with new ways to connect with students and new opportunities and new tactics. What advice have you been passing along to them? What feedback have you been hearing? This has to be probably one of the most remarkable opportunities and challenges that a teacher will ever face.
It is, and especially when the parents are becoming teachers or the family members are becoming teachers. So it's not just about the regular classroom teacher who obviously are working with their own school districts, but it's about how do we help those people at home become teachers to their own children while they're working with their child's teacher. I think one of the best things that we've done is through Trisha Murphy and our faculty with the Classroom and the Living Room podcasts. We've had, I think, about 7 of those dealing with everything from math to reading to things just like your mental health. And those to me have been invaluable to families, but also to teachers, because one of the things we've got to remember for our students, for our teachers, is that these are trying times for everybody. It's about more than just teaching content or how we teach it. It's about reaching out, staying in touch, helping people get the support that they need, whether that's support with understanding a math concept or support with things like I can't pay my rent. And I think the university does a beautiful job with helping our students get what they need in all different areas. I think we really do look at the needs of the whole student. And I'm not sure every university matches that level, and certainly every college on this campus just does a remarkable job keeping their focus there.
Well, Dean, there are a lot of things the college did that folks like me may not have optics on that made the transition that we had to go through because of COVID-19 easier for our students and really kept us on mission. Can you describe the people that helped you accomplish all of this?
Well, we've already talked about the faculty and the department chairs and our school partners. I think one of the key things is that the state of Tennessee has certain requirements for how many days you have to be engaged in student teaching, for the kind of tests you have to take in order to be awarded a teaching license, those sorts of things. So when COVID struck and our students could no longer go into the schools, we had half a semester where they would have been actively engaged with their own students. So how do we make that a process that's not just busy work, but that helps them keep honing their skills about teaching and helps them work toward being licensed? So Bobby Lusher, who's head of our teacher licensure program and our student teacher program, actually worked directly with our students so that the kinds of activities they would be doing in an actual physical school setting, they were still continuing, along with our faculty and our other adjunct supervisors, so that lesson plans and teacher observations were going on. We used videos from the Atlas videos. It's the National Board Certified Teaching, and I probably didn't get that acronym right, but it's based on what the nationally board certified teaching standards are. So we used high quality videos that are not available. We access those all the time for our students. We use the NIET, the National Institute of Education and Teaching videos that are based around TEAM. And what that means is the teacher evaluation system that the state of Tennessee uses. So our students were constantly engaged in those activities and they were constantly getting feedback on them. The other thing that I think is really key and was a surprise to us, the state of Tennessee requires a test called EdTPA in order to get your teaching license. Our students are required to submit those videos to the Pearson Institute prior to mid-semester, so that, because they're externally scored and you have to have a certain score to be certified. Our teachers, our students were already through, that was already behind them, and we learned that a lot of our sister institutions had not gotten to that point. So it's hard to video yourself teaching if you have no students and you're not our school. Ours have already done it. Our scores have always been above, our average has always been above the state requirement. So that's a big hurdle, because with those scores, the teachers can move on to getting their license. They've gotten their degree, they get their license, and we can process those. The state of Tennessee did make an exception on the number of days that you can student teach, but we already had a lot of that covered because of our Residency One program. They're in the schools even more prior to beginning their full-time student teaching program. So all those things together help prepare our students to be hired. MTSU is the number one producer of teachers in this state. We're number one in terms of the number of teachers who are employed first year in the state of Tennessee. We're number one in the number of teachers who are retained in their job beyond the first year. And in the three-year retention, they stay in the job. We're also number one in terms of the most teachers who have the highest level of effectiveness overall as measured by the state. We're number two in terms of the largest number of racially diverse teaching candidates. And we're number two in terms of producing high demand teachers in high demand areas. So we have a lot to live up to. And we didn't want that to flounder because of COVID. That wasn't going to stop us. We're hearing from our students right now saying, I've gotten a teaching job, or can you give me some advice about this interview? We're hearing from school districts asking us to get the word out to our teacher candidates that they have job openings. And our Career Development Center at this university has been incredible in helping us get our teacher candidates connected to the school districts. As you might know, every year in our seminar, final seminar the week of graduation, we have close to 50 future employers here on campus interviewing and hiring our teachers. We couldn't have them here, but because of the Career Development Center, we were able to make a stab at that. It's been as effective as we could hope for.
Well, Dean, if you would allow me to say so, I think we also have the number one dean of that matches the number one rankings that you've mentioned that are certainly pride points for the university. In my old job, I used to criticize reporters who buried their lead, which meant they didn't say the most important news element at the first of their report. And while COVID is definitely a large news story, no question about that, there's also some news that you have as well.
So you're gonna make me tell what that decision is. So I've always known that by a certain age, I was going to keep working, but not for money and not in a job with a title, that I was going to retire. So a couple of months ago, I told the provost and the president that I would be retiring. And I'm just, you know, this university has, I started here as a 17-year-old freshman. So to get to this point, get to end my career here is kind of a unique perspective for me. You said earlier, you know, we have the number one dean, but I got to tell you that I've always believed this. My parents taught me it's not about you. It's not about the title. It's about the people you work for and with. And I believe like so many people who go into education, we do it because we can see the difference we make for children or for students of all ages, college age, whatever. So retirement is just kind of, I don't know, the beginning for everybody else. If you've done your job, people might miss seeing you, but they don't skip a beat. So I think that's been important with every job I've ever left. I've just been very fortunate in my career to have the opportunities I've had. I don't think I could have predicted that when I came here as a freshman, first person in my family to graduate from college, the expectation from my dad that I would do that in 4 years. And it took me 4 years and half a summer because I changed to an education major. It's not something I've ever regretted. And I certainly haven't regretted coming to MTSU twice as a freshman and as dean. And just all the careers in between that I've been afforded I've been extremely blessed. And I think MTSU provided me with a start to that professional journey. And it certainly has given me lifelong friendships and relationships, and wouldn't trade them for anything.
I can't put into words how much you've meant for this university, how much of an honor it's been to work with you. We, the Zoom shows are a little bit more casual, and I don't think it's a state secret for me to share the fact that getting you into the limelight is tough, because you want to talk about everybody else that's connected with the program and you want to talk about the results, and getting you to even agree to this show, I think was probably one of the best accomplishments of my career, because you just don't like talking about yourself and it's all about service.
I've done another show with you now, Andrew.
You have done another show.
I think part of it, when I was commissioner for Governor Bredesen, we were just on air, online, on whatever, all the time. And so I feel like I've had my day in the sun. I really do. And I honestly do feel like it's about the bigger picture. Mm-hmm. It's about that child that some teacher teaches to read. And from here, it's about what our faculty have done to help prepare those teachers to teach that child to read. I mean, there's just so much to being an educator that is rewarding. And if I had the student teachers in front of me, which I don't, but I did at the first of the semester, I always say, don't ever say I'm just a teacher. Because without you, I'm not sure that every other profession could be possible. Because of teachers, people are inspired, they're motivated because of the good teachers. Let me rephrase that. Because of the really good teachers, children think they can. They're motivated, they're inspired, they're prepared in terms of content, in terms of working together. And because of that, places like MTSU can reap the rewards. And I just don't think there's a better profession. And I don't think there's a better place to be trained as a teacher than at Middle Tennessee State University.
And Dean Lana Seivers, former Commissioner of Education for the state of Tennessee, and a fantastic Dean of the College of Education for Middle Tennessee State University, her alma mater. Thanks, Dean.
Thank you, Andrew.
And that does wrap up another edition of Stay on Course. A reminder to check the university's website, mtsu.edu/coronavirus, for news and updates regarding our response to the COVID-19 crisis. I'm Andrew Oppmann. Stay safe, stay on course, and remain true blue.